As futurists, we study trends and factors that impact the future. However, futurists are not crystal ball gazers. We don't just make wild predictions of what the future might be, but rather we gather evidence and extrapolate the trends that are set to shape the years ahead. Businesses and consumers have encountered huge amounts of change in the last few years, and this doesn't appear to be slowing down in 2023. We believe that by observing the demographic shifts, social trends, and technological advancements that have shaped the past, we can make informed predictions about trends set to shape the year ahead. So joining me today to chat through our trend predictions for 2023 is social researcher and director of solutions at McCrindle, Geoff Brailey. Geoff, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ashley. It's great to be here and what a privilege to chat through the trends of the year. It's a pretty exciting episode and stoked to be able to share today.
It's really exciting. Both of us have just been busy in this space over the last few weeks, analyzing lots of different data sets and scoping out what's going on in the world of consumers and businesses. But before we reveal our top trends of 2023, Geoff, as a futurist, what is your favorite thing about this profession of researching and predicting trends?
Yeah, I love looking for the patterns. To me, that's what this is all about, being able to do the reading, do the research, explore and have conversations. And it's a real privilege at McCrindle to chat with great leaders from universities, schools, businesses, charities, religious organizations. We get to chat with a range of different levels from consumers, Gen Z consumers, through to CEOs of top companies. So I really love looking for those patterns in conversations, patterns when we're crunching the numbers, patterns when we're reading other reports and books even. I'm a bit of a book nerd and certainly love looking at what are the trends shaping society. And spotting a trend is really about looking for that similarity. And I even play a game. I was playing it this morning with my kids called Spot It, and it's about matching different animals. And I got beaten by my three-year-old, but that aside, I'm pretty good at spotting trends when it comes to these kind of technological demographic trends. Maybe animal predictions aren't my thing, but looking for those patterns, looking for similarities, and looking for that next step is really, I think, as a futurist, if we can see a couple of dots connecting, well, what does that reveal? What's that picture? If you remember doing those connect the dots as little kids, that's really what we're trying to do here, is connecting those bits of data to really tell a story and see what that picture is of the preferred future that we could shape if we use these trends and see a way to respond to them.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And I think you and I both share in our top five strengths. We've done a lot of that at McCrindle, the Clifton Strengths sort of assessment, and we both have input. So I think it makes sense as to why we like to sort of delve through lots of different data sets and reports to find and decipher these trends. So you and I both were tasked with sharing four of those eight that we have at our event recently. So we're going to go through those. But before we delve into each one in more detail, I thought it might just be helpful to just reveal what those top eight trends are. And if people would like to access more information about this, we do have our event recording that's available for people to access at mccrindle.com/resources. But let's just to start with these eight trends. So, and we'll explain them. So if they don't make sense, that's okay. So number one, recessionette. Number two, population growing pains. Number three, trust doom loop. Number four, virtuous consumerism. Number five, humanit AI. Number six, from industrial to artisan. Number seven, rise of the intrapreneur. And number eight, preparing for the intergenerational transfer. So I think in a bit of a clickbaity way, we have tried to make some of these seem a little bit maybe vague or hard to decipher because they are complex in some ways. And so we're going to spend some time unpacking each of these, and some of them are new terms that we've kind of coined. But let's begin with your four, Geoff, that you presented at the event, the first four. So the first one is recessionette. It's a bit of a new term that we've coined. Geoff, what does it mean?
Yeah, thanks for introducing the eight trends there. And recessionette, I'm glad we're starting with this one. We'll get to trust doom loop. You got past that without skipping a beat. That was a lot of fun to research for each of these trends. And we're really looking across demographic, economic factors. And the recessionette is really impacting consumers. But what is it? Are we mispronouncing recession? No, we're actually saying it's a recessionette. It feels like a recession without it technically being a recession. And a recession is when we have, as a nation, any nation has two quarters of negative growth. So the economy isn't performing well. And that's when there's some really significant impacts. Job losses occur, there's no increases in wages. And so we really don't want a recession as a society, because it really does lead to significant impacts that, if you end up with really devastating times, it's because you've had multiple recessions kind of building on each other. And that leads to the sort of depression that happened 100 years ago in the 1930s globally. We don't want to go down that track, but it actually feels like a recession at the moment. Now, there's a few kind of economic kind of data points that really reveal why it feels like a recession. We've got rising inflation at the moment. We've got interest rates continuing to rise. We've got a range of conditions that have probably made consumers feel like, I just don't quite have enough at the moment. That spending power is gone. If you're going to the petrol bowser, if you're at the grocery store, if you're paying school fees, if you're looking for those holidays or opportunities to do that hobby, everything's just gone up. And so that spending power doesn't quite match it like it used to maybe a couple of years ago. And I think we're all noticing those emails in the inbox where it's like, oh, just a quick update on our policies and terms and conditions. The price is going up too, by the way. So that feel of, where's our surplus in the budget's gone at a household level. And I think at an organisational level too, we can sort of anticipate that the marketing budget across organisations is going to be slightly less this year. 4 in 5 marketers in the APAC region said they've got less to play with in one study. So we know that there's a bit of a challenge ahead for businesses, but particularly for the everyday consumer, because there are the haves and the have-nots in society. There is that sort of wealth divide, whether it's income, whether it's the assets that we've got. And we've got a couple of infographics on that for Australia, the wealth and income infographic that shows the kind of community split into 5 groups of 20%, those quintiles. And it shows a really pretty compelling, in some ways, disastrous story in our society, those haves and have-nots. And as we go into this recessionette in 2023, it's going to be some challenging times for people right across those 5 quintiles, because not just the kind of poorer parts of society will feel that burden. It's going to impact right up those 4 or 5 quintiles as cost of living goes up, petrol prices, rents going up as well. So pretty challenging trend to start with. So it's a bit gloomy. The positive note at the end of this really is, though, that it's a low unemployment market. That's the saving grace at the moment. We don't have kind of jobs being cut here in Australia at the moment. And while there might be some globally because of some of the other trends that we'll get to in a moment around AI, what we're really seeing, though, at the moment is it's a really strong job market, which is good for employees. It's their moment in the sun where there's a bit more bargaining power. And so it's a good little silver lining to probably a pretty challenging first trend.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was interesting when we conducted a study just a few weeks ago to inform this particular trends event and beef out some of these sort of concepts, and for us to gauge where people are at. We asked about how concerned people are about a range of different things, and we found that 57% of Australians said they're extremely or very concerned about rising interest rates. When we segmented that by generation, it went up to 73% of Generation Z who may be looking out at their economic future and trying to maybe purchase a property or invest in this kind of tough market. So rising interest rates. Then we talked about how concerned are you about global uncertainty, and 60% of Australians said extremely or very concerned, and 79% said they were extremely or very concerned about the rising cost of living. So yeah, it's really, I guess, like you said, Geoff, whether we enter a technical recession or not, there is that feeling and it's having impact on consumer spending. So a bit of a, yeah, tougher, maybe more negative one to start with, but a reality of our sort of economic times at the moment. The second and one that
I'll just pause on. Sorry, just one final comment, because it is a reality that feels like a recession. The opportunity is there, though, amidst uncertainty, for leaders to find that opportunity, because people will be looking for those savings, looking for those initiatives. So if you get your messaging right, even in a recessionette, you can grow, you can expand, you can look for those opportunities to add more services to existing customers. So I think for anyone in a sales or kind of marketing function at the moment, that's a real, probably just don't get too gloomy. This is actually still a great moment to be kind of expanding and kind of have that positive outlook on the conditions. So let's go to the second trend, though. Ash, sorry to hold up there, but I think that's a real practical point for those listeners that are in that sort of outward focused kind of role. It's not a close up the shop, give up, actually there's more businesses opening now than ever because it's a great opportune time to look into a growing population point. So how's that for a segue for you for trend number two?
Yeah, no, it's really good to have that perspective as well. And like you said, Geoff, the population has been growing in some interesting ways over the last few years with impacts of closed borders and people moving within populations, which does lead to our second trend around population growing pains, which my understanding is that's basically the fact that large scale, rapid population movements from some of our capital cities to our regional areas has brought with it some opportunities for those areas, but also a few growing pains that these areas will need to manage. How'd I go? Is that a pretty good summary of that one, Geoff?
That's great. And let's get technical. I know the listeners will love getting into some acronyms. We always joke about it in the office, all these three-letter, four-letter acronyms. And let's talk NOM, NIM and NI, which is the three ways a location can grow. You can grow through natural increase where births outnumber deaths. You can grow through net interstate migration, the NIM, which is where you can grow through sort of that border crossing across states or territories. There's been plenty of that when the international borders were closed. People were adjusting their seats on the boat, looking for that better location to endure lockdowns or find a new opportunity for the decade ahead. And we do now have NOM, the net overseas migration, back and certainly ramped up for Australia and many other countries as well would be experiencing those transfers of populations across borders internationally. Now, for a lot of locations and people listening to this, they might have already made that shift to a region. And last year in 2022, we talked about a trend, the rise of the regions. Well, this year the trend is population growing pains because the regions aren't keeping up in terms of the infrastructure needed to support kind of the lifestyle that people move to that area for, whether it be the healthcare services that's waiting at emergencies or to find a GP appointment. There's not quite enough service provision in the health or in education. It might be the challenge to get students into schools or get that care for those younger children in early learning centres. And I think part of this really begins to reveal that the regions wanted growth. It got probably dialed up a little bit more than they anticipated because those global factors impacted where people wanted to live. We've looked for more affordability and lifestyle and employability, and the regions that are experiencing that, places like Southeast Queensland, it's a lifestyle area, that Sunshine Coast down to the Gold Coast with Brisbane in the heart there, Toowoomba out to the west. It's a beautiful area and it's got the triple green light of the natural increase. It's growing that way. It's growing through net interstate migration where people are leaving New South Wales, Victoria, moving to Queensland, as well as it's a global destination location city with the Olympics in less than a decade now. So that Southeast Queensland has great growth, and other places across Australia like WA, South Australia have that growth as well. And there'd be other pockets around the globe as well that are experiencing that triple green light of growth in regions. The pain point is, how do you keep up that service delivery? And so local leaders are really probably scratching their heads thinking, what can we do to support our community and continue to grow in a sustainable way? And that's about managing that infrastructure provision. And so doing the audits, doing the checklist is the real action step there, seeing where the gaps are at the moment, those pain points, and finding solutions. And that's the real challenge right now. It's a problem-solving trend here for leaders to respond to.
Yeah, it's always good for us to include a demographic trend. It has big implications for communities and how we live. So it's a really important one. The next one, though, is a little bit more complex. Trust doom loop. I think it definitely warrants an explanation. And Geoff, you were tasked with sharing about this one in our event. How do you describe or explain this trend to people?
Yeah, kind of approach this trend, recognizing that in society today, there are a range of differing views on key topics. Now, why do we have differing views at the moment in society? Well, we do have different generations. There's six different generations in society. We've got a range of different cultures. We live in global times. We are global citizens. We have a range of views from religion through to technology practices through to what the family should look like or what healthcare should look like. And having gone through some pretty wild times, turbulent times over these last COVID years, I think what we've identified in this trend is that we're in an era where there's been a slight decline again in institutional organizations, be it kind of media, be it business, be it government, be it big tech. There's a bit of a kind of just another drop down the peg, unfortunately, with trust in institutions. Now, in a study we did in January this year, we found that people have just had a slight dip in their trust in business and in government. The big kind of jump, though, is in the trust in media. And so people are looking for views that are coming from alternative sources. And I'm not trying to say this is all about conspiracies, but people are just looking for differing worldviews and information that supports their worldview. And we've got so many different worldviews. I remember doing a Bachelor of Theology about 15 years ago, learning about how we see the world through kind of a faith lens. If you've got a faith kind of upbringing or continue on in a faith tradition, you'll have that as one of the lenses, almost like a pair of sunglasses that affect the way you see things. Or if you've kind of grown up with a political kind of lens, a pair of political sunglasses that you wear, those pairs of sunglasses that we wear for a range of different things, whether you're an Apple person or an Android person, you wear a pair of sunglasses, those technological sunglasses, or financial. Are you a frugal person, a saver, or are you a spender or a traveler? Get out there and fill that backpack full of experiences and fill that tummy full of great food. We all have different lenses, ways we see the world, and we're looking for information that supports the way we live. We probably avoid some of that conflicting information. And so there's a rise in alternate views, different media providing those bits of information. Now, this trust doom loop is first step about kind of the decline in trust in leaders and key organizations. The second step is the rise in alternative views. If governments and institutions respond by restricting those alternative views, it's just going to simply reinforce that you shouldn't trust governments, you shouldn't trust these big institutions. So it's a bit of a doom loop. If governments and organizations and institutions restrict it, it'll just kind of tick that confirmation bias that says, yeah, we should never have trusted that organization or that source of news. And the doom loop continues, and you kind of have a decline in trust. And so you look for more alternate views, and that rise continues. And then if they respond with greater restrictions, it will just circle around and around and around. It's not very positive in terms of building a community, particularly in a democratic society. We've got so much diversity in our society. And so the real takeaway point here for leaders is avoid the doom loop by understanding diverse views. A range of communication methods are going to be needed, not just to get your message out there, but to listen to society and to those segments. And that's really, I think, where the power of research, the power of stakeholder engagement comes in. Because if you're just using one source of news, be it a traditional, a digital, a social, it doesn't matter whether it's a new or an old kind of means, you just need to have variety of those channels to hear what's going on as well as to get messages through. So pretty challenging times. And I think leaders need to have a fair bit of authenticity in this process, because that's the thing that has caused the decline in leadership trust, is that leaders haven't handled situations around integrity well or money. And so some of that authenticity in character as well as in processes, accountabilities, certainly needs to be upheld as well. So it's a pretty interesting trend. I know I mentioned the word conspiracies. I don't think this is just about sort of a health view or a technological view. I think each individual listening would have things that they differ on compared to the mainstream. And I think this is the real point, is there's not just one mainstream anymore. There's so many different parts of society that are large in our community, be it from cultural diversity, faith backgrounds, sporting preferences, technological use, the way we want to live in our cities, or the way we want to shop and eat and consume products and buy services. So there's so much diversity. We've really got to make sure our democracy holds up to that diversity in our community.
Yeah, it's really well described there, Geoff. Thank you. The fourth trend is virtuous consumerism, which, as the title suggests, is about consumers and our behaviour. How do you think the virtuous part, I guess, well, what does the virtuous part of this allude to? What is this trend all about?
Yeah, we're really shifting our patterns of consumption from racing to the cheapest products, which sort of was that globalization trend that kind of came through in the 90s and noughties, where we started to see, yep, you can buy anything, it's made overseas, don't ask too many questions. But now we do ask questions. We do want to understand the supply chain. Was there child labor hopefully not involved? We do want to know, does this organization stack up when it comes to the Modern Slavery Act? We do want to know, is there fair trade? Are workforces being looked after? And it's a real shift from just sort of the the bottom line being the bottom line, and it's all about price. Now, price still matters, but we've seen an introduction 25 years ago of a phrase called triple bottom line reporting, which was more than just the P of price. There's three P's in this. It's about price. It's about the planet. Are we looking after the resources of Mother Nature, of the world that we live in? And so our organizations kind of operating in a sustainable way, looking after the planet for future generations rather than just making a quick buck today. And then the third P is all around people. And so it's not just the staff, it's about the supply chain, it's about the stakeholder and the brand, the consumer. And so there's that real alignment that I think consumers today have with organizations that are authentic in their messaging, transparent in their communication about supply chains. And so it's pretty alarming. Ethical fashion study by Baptist World Aid Australia found that I think it was 2 in 5 companies don't know where their raw materials come from. So they can't report on it, can't communicate it authentically. And so there's a bit of an audit that needs to happen for organizations so that consumers can see sort of a bit into that glass box transparency that they're looking for as they use their spending power for good. They're wanting to make decisions that don't just benefit themselves, but build a better world. And so that's a rise this year we thought was worth including as a trend of the year, because it's not just about sustainability or climate action. This is about everyday decisions, whether it's shopping local and supporting local farmers. It's about supporting small businesses. It's about making sure that companies that we might invest with in our super are doing good things for the planet and for people. And so there's a bit of a shift occurring as a younger generation, Gen Z and Gen Y, are into those kind of earning years now, building those super accounts and really asking the question, is this money being used well ethically from a sustainability as well as a governance and environmental perspective? So look for more of that ESG kind of reporting to be a key factor for young consumers going forwards.
Yeah, it's a really interesting one as consumer behaviour sort of shifts, and even as we enter this kind of recessionette feel and we're looking at the price of things, maybe more so, it's also other factors as well, not just like you said, that sole aspect of the bottom line is just what is the cost. It's actually more going into the consumer decision now, which is really interesting. The next trend, which I was tasked with sharing about, which was really interesting to research and look up and look at all the trends about, is Humanit AI. So we're a bit of a pun, a bit of a play on words. It's easier if you can see it, because you know the term humanity, spelt H-U-M-A-N-I-T-Y, we've kind of put a play on that word and put H-U-M-A-N-I-T-AI. So artificial intelligence is what we're talking about here, the rise of artificial intelligence. And just basically, I think with this trend, what we were trying to communicate was that in 2023 and looking out over the next few years, we're really going to see AI kind of arrive. I feel like it's been something that we've been talking about in our, you know, trends presentations, our changing times, emerging trends content for probably the whole time I've been working at McCrindle, the last almost 10 years. And now it really feels like it's arrived. I mean, we've got ChatGPT, we've got the metaverse. That was a trend that we were talking about, you know, for 2022, for last year. But really that digital transformation in the world of artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality, the Internet of Things, cloud computing, all of this really accelerating in 2023. And I guess even the interconnectedness of these things and blurring of those boundaries is really creating a more personalized and efficient process and system for people. So we saw that in some of the scoping research we conducted. There was one study which I came across that said 65% of tasks can be automated by an AI-powered customer care ecosystem. So that idea that there are tasks, there are jobs, there are processes that we will start to see really be used by AI. And that's really natural, I think, for people to be a little bit scared of. Maybe they've got a bit of a dystopian look on, you know, the ethics and the involvement of machines in our lives and in our work. And we, you and I, Geoff, were putting together some questions for this survey that we've been referencing. And it was interesting to see some of the responses or the perspective that people have around artificial intelligence. So one of the statements we tested was, I'm excited to see how AI/robots will save me time on domestic tasks in the next year. And 20% of the Australian population said they agree with that statement. However, when we segmented it by generation, that 20% increased to 64% among Gen Z. So the early adopters, they're used to change in technology. They're really seeing the benefits of their of that aspect. But then we also tested some other statements like, I am nervous that AI will replace human jobs. And 74% of the population agreed with that. So 3 in 4 people agreed. And interestingly, 92%, an incredibly high proportion of the population, said they prefer talking to a human than engaging with an AI chatbot. So I guess our sentiment here is that in 2023, we're definitely going to see artificial intelligence continue to evolve. There's lots of conversations already about ChatGPT and the impact of that on the education sector and perspectives here. But I don't think have to be super concerned or worried because, you know, artificial intelligence, robotics is always at its best when humans are involved in the loop. And there's hopefully the use of these machines and technologies take out that repetitive, they can do the heavy lifting tasks and we can do that higher order thing. I mean, it's interesting even with ChatGPT, like it's amazing the capacity it can do just when you're sipping your coffee, you can put in a question and it pops out a big response to something. I have tested a few things. I tested one question, which was like, who is Generation Alpha? And it gave me a really good snapshot. I was like, this is good. And then I asked another one, who coined the term Generation Alpha? And it came up with Mark McCrindle's Australian-based social researcher. And then it went into like some other things. And it was like, yeah, they're the generation after the millennials. And I was like, okay, well, that's wrong. And there was a few other things. So it's not entirely factual or correct. It's still going to need the human perspective, the wisdom. But I guess, yeah, it's understandable that people are a bit nervous. I mean, is that what you're seeing as well in the people you speak to, Geoff, around artificial intelligence and it sort of arriving, you know, this year?
Yeah, that's right. It's certainly got a lot of people talking over that sort of summer break for those down under, the winter break in the Northern Hemisphere. The big thing I think is, what do we want it to do? It might be able to recall a lot of information, and we're really just sort of starting to scratch our head and think, is what would it do in this part of my life? If you're volunteering on a board or if you're involved in a community, it's like, oh, if it can save time there, that'd be brilliant. But maybe don't take my job. I don't want to change my job or have to change at my job. So I think there's that little bit of nervousness in some areas, excitement in other areas. What I think it really presents is an opportunity to experience information in a really different way. We've shifted from searching for information and just getting links, which is sort of what the traditional search engine did back when I was in high school, the first time using the internet. It was amazing. So much information was available and you could just find links to different things. We then started to shift towards that YouTube experience where we wanted to watch things. It was someone, a real person speaking to us, kind of that bit of kind of a learning shift from reading to watching. But now it's actually being sort of produced in a really natural language. You don't get a link to something. You get a almost human-like response of that information in conversational language or essay format. Whatever you put in, it will do that for you. So the way we're able to access information is really different, and the applications of that are, I think, really just being tested right now across the majority of society. And that's the real rise. As you said, this has been around for 10 years. We've been talking about AI. It's now kind of just hit every workplace, every organization, thinking through, what does it mean for me? Whereas things like last year when we're talking about trends of the year, and we're talking about NFTs, those non-fungible tokens, or cryptocurrency, some of those metaverse type trends, that was just for those people over there interested in early adoption. This has now hit every workplace, every organization, be it education, not-for-profit, banking, thinking through how can this save us time and where could this benefit our customers and improve our experience overall.
Yeah, it's really important, I think, for every business leader to be thinking about and be evaluating how they can hopefully use these sorts of tools to their advantage and to the team's advantage, which is an interesting time to be operating as a business.
I've got to admit as well, Ash, I typed in what would be the trends of 2023 into ChatGPT to see if it could do that predictive work. It debunked it, couldn't look ahead because it is a historical analysis tool. So I think that's where it's not sort of the back to the future predictions of who's going to win the Super Bowl, who's going to win the grand final this year in the AFL, go the Giants, just getting that in there. But I think the point is this is a helpful bit of information gathering and communication. It's different to having that wisdom or that ability to interpret information. And that's where critical thinking skills, you've talked about that a lot in your sort of education sessions. And I think that's where we're all learning how to use a new technology here. So it's not just those Gen Zs learning about technology. Every person in the workplace really, I think, needs to have an awareness of how AI can help improve their organization.
Yeah, absolutely. For trends 6 and 7, we had two that were kind of interconnected. So we had from industrial to artisan and rise of the intrapreneur. So when it comes to that industrial to artisan trend, we're talking here about a move away from, I guess, manual and industrial labor due to, in part, the sophistication and adoption of AI, like we just talked about, to work being about value added rather than how much we can output from a work sense. But it's also, I guess, resulting in a counter trend from mass production to quality, niche and unique products and services. So as people focus more on local impacts, artisan products and working with purpose, it seems that bigger is not always better. And again, I'm reminded of some of the trends you even mentioned earlier about virtuous consumerism. So a lot of these are quite interconnected. Yeah. And then we had the rise of the intrapreneur. And if people don't know what that term is, an intrapreneur is basically someone who has an interest in being or becoming an entrepreneur or conducting or doing or starting a side hustle while they participate in traditional employment. So hence that intrapreneur rather than entrepreneur. Often intrapreneurs are pretty highly engaged and innovative workers like entrepreneurs, but they often work within an organization. And we were looking at a lot of trends around, you know, the rise of side hustles and people holding down multiple jobs and starting their own small businesses. And so I guess for us, one of the impacts of this is that if organizations want someone who is purely focused and solely focused on their sort of area, they almost need to pay a premium for that undivided attention from their employees. And I think, again, another implication of this we talked about in our event is as a result, we can probably expect to see a leadership shift away from monitoring to mentoring and doubling down on culture to attract and retain great talent. So it's a lot around workforce and also some lingering impacts from the pandemic and changing how, where, when people work, what they're looking for in their work, from that monitoring everyone in the office all the time or the workplace to work from home and flexibility and interesting leadership shifts that go along with that. But would you agree with those trends, Geoff? Do you see those happening in our clients and in the research as well?
Yeah, absolutely. And we've sort of shifted away from probably that business strategy kind of paradigm of the experience curve where you just do things quicker, faster, cheaper. And that's still true. That's part of that virtuous consumerism. People are looking for that boutique or handmade or a little bit of personalization, a brand that or an influencer on social media that's got personality, builds their own community. Oh, that's really unique. And that's, I think, it's not the consumer perspective, it's the employee perspective here. And rather than people going out and taking all the risks of starting their own business, they want to demonstrate that initiative, that innovative approach. And being, I think, an entrepreneur has a pretty high status these days. People want to have that success, but they want to have that success modified within their risk profile. And I think for a lot of people, they're not prepared to bet their house and future savings on that crazy idea that they've got. They're prepared to do that on work time in some work money, using work money. And it really takes, I think, leaders shifting from that monitoring to mentoring to get that best growth for that organization. Now, I think if you even take it a step back further, probably the workplace, if you go back probably 20 to 50 years, it was about you had a master, not just a monitor. You had someone that told you what to do and you got it done. Yes, sir. Quick and done yesterday sort of thing. So we've gone from the master to the monitor, someone that's your supervisor. They're there for you, but it's still get the job done. They're just watching and hopefully not micromanaging. But now it's about that mentoring and probably that self-directed growth journey, because it's an employee's market right now. There is that low unemployment. So to get the best out of your staff, you really got to develop them. And yeah, Ash, you've used a great quote, I think, from one of your favorites, Sir Richard Branson, around talent, about what is it? It's about hiring people and then training them well enough so that they'll stay. Do you remember that one?
Putting them on the spot. Train people well enough so they can leave, treat them well enough so they don't want to.
Yeah, brilliant. And that's the era I think we're in, where it's about training people to be that intrapreneur. How do you help people learn the skills of an entrepreneur without the risk? Because that will attract people. They'll see the growth. The company or the organization will experience the benefit. So it's a great trend, I think, that one, that applies to every organization, whether you're not-for-profit or for-profit, certainly applies to all organizations.
Yeah, and I think in this, you know, rapidly changing world that we're living in, hence, you know, this episode on helping people understand the trends and what might shape the year ahead, organizations need to be innovative and nimble, and to have people in your team who are ready to take risks or help your organization do that while they're working for you, I think that's great. So hopefully, yeah, people do view this trend as a positive one, especially if they're a business leader or an owner. And you mentioned
just,
there, Geoff,
just quickly, I was just going to say a quick comment. If people are interested in like that entrepreneurial attitude and how do you develop a business strategy that releases that within your own organization, there's a great book, The Lords of Strategy, and it talks about you could create new kind of revenue sources from existing industries or new industries with existing products or new products or services. And so there's some great kind of terminology and skill sets and even just mental frameworks to think as leaders about what types of growth do we want to see? Do we want to take a full leap with a new product into a new industry, or do we just take an existing product into a new industry? Or you kind of can picture that there's a table there in that book. So definitely recommend leaders checking out that book. I've loved it, and I recommend it to a lot of the business leaders I talk to.
Yeah, I've heard you recommend it too, I think, which is always good to get a book recommendation from someone who's got input in their strengths. And our final trend, which again, we've talked a little bit about, I guess, putting a generational lens on a few of the other trends, but this last and final trend is really all about preparing for the intergenerational transfer. And we included this one because, you know, over the course of 2023, we are going to see some significant generational transitions take place. So if we start at our youngest generation, our generation alphas, the oldest of them are becoming teenagers for the first time in 2023. So we did a whole podcast episode about that with Mark, understanding what this kind of move in their life stage will mean for them and for their parents and educators and leaders, but also business leaders. We've got our Generation Zs who are really in their late teens now, but mostly their 20s. So understanding them as the future emerging employee particularly. Then we've got our Gen Ys who, it's really interesting, both of us belong to the Gen Y generation. And I'm always sometimes make the joke, I made it at a conference that I was involved with recently, where I said, I miss the days where millennial meant young person, because now the millennials, you know, us Gen Ys are really well and truly into our 30s and even 40s. And the youngest technically, you know, part of this generation are in their final year of their 20s. The youngest generation wise are 29, you know, this year. So as of next year, they will all be, you know, in our 30s or above. So in that key family forming life stage, very busy. Then we've got our Generation X's who are really our key workplace and political leaders in some respect. And our oldest generation, our baby boomers and our builders, really, I guess, preparing for retirement. And I guess with that comes all of society needing to work together to understand how we can support them, how we can support the aging population. We've done a fair bit of research around that sector particularly and how much demand there is with a real lack of supply. So lots of different generational things to be aware of. And we even put in our infographic summarizing all these trends that often we think about the generational transfer, whether it's knowledge or wisdom or even finance or wealth, being very linear. But actually, we do see it really, I guess, in 2023 and beyond being a bit more collaborative as we transfer wealth and knowledge between different generations, as we learn from younger employees and they upskill us on how to use AI or ChatGPT, whatever it might be. So yeah, some interesting ways to, I guess, navigate some of those challenges is by drawing on the strengths of different generations. Does that excite you, Geoff? I know we always love to talk about the generations. Does that excite you as much as it excites me?
Yeah, I think that's right. It's certainly a really beautiful opportunity in society for each generation to appreciate the other generation. And I think at McCrindle, we're pretty positive about that intergenerational communication. We don't want to see generational warfare. We want to see, and not just harmony and kind of being too nice and keeping at arm's length, but we want to see that interaction of generations, and a bit of banter's great fun. And it's that, if you get very practical, it's that skill development across generations, whether it's how to buy a house. Well, yeah, baby boomers are probably going to be better at teaching the Gen Ys and Gen Zs how they did it. And while the times might be slightly different, they've done it. They can talk you through that once in a lifetime experience, whereas the Gen Zs, Gen Ys can probably teach the older generations how to set up a YouTube account, how to create those digital kind of streaming services, how to optimize and save passwords without having a written thing on your taped on your computer screen. Or I've seen a few shockers, to be honest, there. So that's if you get to that skill kind of transition across generations, let alone knowledge, experience, wisdom, wealth, there's certainly not just a linear approach anymore. It is the Gen Zs teaching baby boomers. It's the Gen Xs teaching Gen Y. It's Gen Y teaching the builders. And I think that's when societies are at its best, when there is shared learning and respect across all generations. And I think there is still that slight little opportunity for honouring our older generations. Maybe I'm old-fashioned, but I think there is a bit of respect needed to be given to those older. But also I think that's a two-way street. I think the younger generations are looking for respect as they give respect as well. They don't want to be trashed as the young generation, and Gen Y certainly not the young generation anymore. So I think we're looking for a society today that really embraces the strengths of each generation and the development opportunities, those growth opportunities as they face uncharted territory. And for Gen Zs and Gen Ys, it's those family forming and raising teenagers and handling lots of complexity, as you mentioned there. So I think you've absolutely got that right, that it's an exciting time as we see that intergenerational transfer of skills, knowledge, and experience.
Yeah, absolutely. We think 2023 is going to be a big year, hopefully, you know, communicated by all these insights we've shared today. So it's been great to have you on the podcast today, Geoff. I think we've done well to get through a lot of trends, a lot of content in this episode. So thanks so much for your time. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, pleasure to be here, and I hope people enjoy checking out the event recording, as well as there's an infographic and an article there for people to check it out. So yeah, great one to use in your teams and really start the year with those trends. And you can now check back on this episode in the future as well and see how we did, how we've predicted the future with that crystal ball gazing as we've looked at the evidence, looked at the data, and really anticipated those patterns. So thanks for having me on, Ash, to talk trends of 2023.
Yeah, and like you said, Geoff, if people would like to stay up to date with our latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media. Or like Geoff said, you can access our Trends of 2023 infographic or the event recording if you really want to delve into those insights that we shared and some of this data. And you can find all of that at McCrindle.com/resources. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.